Hello there. This is not a 15-minute introduction, don't worry. I just wanted to say hello and happy Christmas, season's greetings, and all the best for the new year as well. Happy New Year. This is a little bonus episode for you to listen to during the festive period. And this is a conversation, a kind of game show with Paul Taylor. Okay, this episode is sponsored by Luke's English Podcast Premium, of course. To gain access to over 100 premium episodes with audio and video, PDFs, vocab, grammar and pronunciation work, just go to teacherluke.co.uk/premium info and you'll find all the details and you'll be able to sign up there. Okay, have a lovely festive period and I hope you enjoy this episode. That's all from me and let's get started with the jingle. You're listening to Luke's English Podcast. For more information, visit teacherluke.co.uk. Hello, listeners. Welcome to this podcast. Am I going to start the episode like that, do you think?
Yeah.
Do you think, shall I do it without any kind of rambling 15-minute introduction in the beginning?
Could you imagine that? That would be good, wouldn't it?
Imagine just jumping straight in.
When was the last time that you didn't do an intro and it just jumped in?
It's been a while. I think maybe the last time that you and Amber were on the podcast.
You didn't do an intro. I thought you did. It's because we always make fun of you at the beginning. It's like, oh, here we go. This will be another 15-minute intro.
Those 15-minute intros are important, I think sometimes.
I think they are to establish context, right? But then also you have those intros on your website.
It's the same, so
people can read the intro and then just listen.
The thing on the text on the website is the script to the intro.
Yeah.
So the idea is that I want to provide people with a transcript as much as possible. If I've written the whole thing out in advance, I might as well stick the text on the website too. And most of the time, when people listen to the podcast, they're not on the website. It's only about what percentage actually visit the website, but it's a very small percentage who actually go.
Do you get statistics about when people, like, which parts of the podcast people listen to?
No, I don't.
Could not, you? And then you just can't be bothered. I have a bunch of statistics, but I don't have time.
So on YouTube, you get those very detailed stats where it shows you audience retention and the audience, it shows you a line of at the beginning of the video, everyone's watching and then the line slowly goes down as people basically just stop watching you for some reason. It's quite depressing looking at that line.
Yeah.
It's never just a straight line, horizontal line. It always tapers off and you think, oh, you bastards, why aren't you listening to me? So you get that on YouTube, but I don't actually look at that stuff on YouTube.
Right, okay.
I'm not using YouTube like that. It's not going to, I'm just not doing that. For the podcast stats, no, I don't get the same audience retention stuff.
Okay, interesting. I thought podcast analytics was even better than YouTube.
Podcast analytics are pretty good, but YouTube is the best, I think, in terms of the data that they can give to you as a content creator.
I see.
But yeah, one other reason I don't look at the YouTube audience retention figures is because I feel like YouTube is not representative of how my audience, for the most part, listen to my episodes.
Right, yeah, of course, yeah.
And so I don't want to look at YouTube stats too much because they're going to influence me, you know?
Yeah, I know what you mean. I'm the same with the opposite, which is because my live show is a podcast, but it's not really. I mean, it's just, I just upload the audio with a bit of extra 15-minute intro of talking shit, because I figured if I was going to make it into a podcast, because there was like two people that said to me, hey Paul, I don't have time to watch it on YouTube, I don't have time to have the screen on and whatever, if I'm driving, there's no way of me listening I want to listen to the show, but is there a way of doing it? So I listened to one person out of the 5,000 and was like, shit, I should make this a podcast.
Yes.
So I bought a paid money to have a host the podcast.
What's his name?
Podbean. That's his name.
Dave Podbean?
Yeah.
He's like, welcome to the podcast.
No, that's his brother. That's his brother. He's the one who actually makes, who runs a local grocery store. That's David Podbean.
The Podbean Cafe.
Yeah, Michael is the one who runs the the podcasting service.
Mike Podbean.
Yeah, Mike Podbean.
And, oh, what are we talking about? What are we on about?
We are talking utter bollocks.
Oh, dear. You know, sometimes I feel like all I have to do occasionally is just open my mouth and say one thing, and then I end up spending ages kind of...
An hour talking about
explaining it. Like, for example, the fact that some of
like
my...
Like the Russian joke.
No, not that. I mean that, like, for example, the fact I've just mentioned that my podcast is on YouTube, but some people now will be thinking, what, there's like videos of all this? No, there isn't. What I do is that I make an audio podcast occasionally, that I do videos, like the one with English with Lucy that I did recently, for example. But no, I also upload the audio episodes onto YouTube with just a static image on the screen.
Yeah, didn't you do one where you added like photos of London or England or something in the background?
So that was the recent...
Is that the one? Okay.
No, it's a competition that I did.
Oh, recently. And they have photos from your listeners?
No, but here we go, just explaining.
Don't worry about it. We'll talk about it offline if you don't want to talk about it.
Well, I feel like now I've mentioned it, just give me 30 seconds.
But why do you not film?
Because it's all far too much hassle for me.
I agree.
I do an audio podcast, all right? And no one is going to drag me onto YouTube fully, okay? That's not what I do. That's not what this is. This is an audio podcast. I'm not getting YouTubed, okay?
You're not fully.
Even though saying that, I'm hoping to get to 100,000 subscribers soon.
Oh, how many are you at?
I'm at 81,000.
Oh, we'll get you some more tonight for the live.
Yeah, so I'm on your live, your YouTube live later on, so maybe we can get a few more people subscribing.
Yeah, absolutely.
But Paul Taylor's back on the podcast.
Oh yeah, we don't have the jingle just for me.
I don't
we're
have
missing
the jingle.
We're missing Amber Minogue.
Paul is normally Amber and Paul are on the podcast, but I did it before where I just did the jingle with don't you remember? I had the music in the background. I can't do that this time because I don't have the audio plugged in, but it would be Paul is on the podcast.
I do.
Paul is on the podcast. Paul is on another podcast. Paul's a very funny boy. His laugh I very much enjoy.
No.
If I could... No. The amber bit has
to be
silent.
Longer, yeah.
And then just, yeah, at the end.
You got to improvise. You got to create some new stuff.
So, listeners, Paul Taylor's back on the podcast. Long-term listeners will know, obviously, that Paul is a friend of the podcast, a frequent guest, a returning guest. But you haven't been on...
For a long time.
For quite a few months now. And I expect there are quite a lot of listeners who've started listening recently and haven't really heard episodes with you. So basically, yes, long-term guest. There may be some references to things that you don't know, listeners. Anyway, Paul.
Yes.
What I thought we would do for this is...
Should we spend an hour reintroducing myself for the people who don't know? Can you imagine? No, I'm joking. I'm clearly
like,
joking.
Of the many hours we've spent, can we just recap on every single thing?
I really miss those days. I don't know where I would come round and I was figuring out what I was doing with my life and we were on your terrace, a previous terrace of the old place. Yeah, I don't know. I miss that part. I don't know. There's something about that. It's just nostalgia.
There were days before certain types of pressure arrived in our lives.
Yeah.
For you, obviously, you know, for both of us, family, kids and stuff.
Yeah.
But also for you, just like career-wise, you just quit your job at Apple and decided to go into stand-up full-time. And it was kind of like, okay, you hadn't done it yet. You hadn't sort of, your career hadn't taken off yet. So everything was possible.
Exactly, yeah. And... it was the as you said, everything was possible. And when you're starting out in whatever career that you're doing, whether you know it's comedy, whether it's accounting, that you look up and you're like, wow, there's so many things. Like, where do I want to go? What do I want to do? And the sort of further along you get in that journey, and the more you see the things that you could do go past you, and you're like, oh, I did that. Then you start going, oh, well. What do I want to do now? Like, I'm so far in it that what happens if I don't want to do this aspect of it anymore? And I want to do a new part, then am I going to lose? I mean, specifically with comedy, like, are you going to lose your audience if you go and do some other stuff that isn't what I've been doing so far?
Yeah.
You know, in all jobs, it's probably very similar.
It's also like the CPU of your computer now. There's like many different tasks that your CPU is dealing with in the background, you know?
Exactly.
Yeah, you've got all these tasks running in the background. Your computer's, your brain memory is being taken up by your daughter, you know, and other responsibilities. Whereas in the old days, it was just like fresh new MacBook Pro. And it's just
and it had
zip,
one
zip,
thing
zip,
to do. Yeah.
Zip, zip, zip. One thing to do. What is that one thing? Just do this podcast now and have fun.
Exactly.
So it's just ping, 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 ping. Lots of ideas coming out and stuff like that. Anyway, Paul.
Yes, tell me.
So I've decided that this episode is going to be called Random Questions with Paul Taylor.
I like it.
Okay, let me explain what I've done here to prepare for this. So I've written about 50 questions and challenges on various topics in no particular order.
Okay.
Okay. They're just conversation starters, really.
Yep.
So basically what I'll ask you to do is tell me a number from 1 to 50, and I'll ask you that question or set you that challenge.
Yeah.
There are no right or wrong answers. I wrote that before I'd finished writing the whole thing. So actually...
You're about as organized as I am. I like it.
There are some right or wrong answers in some cases. Okay. So as well as my random questions,
yes.
And most of these are my random questions, but as well as those, there are also other things, including these categories. Okay. Are you ready? So one of them is guess the idiom.
Okay.
Which you might remember, we did that ages and ages ago, years ago, vocab battle, those episodes where I define an expression and you have to tell me what it is.
Oh, yeah, okay. That's a good game. I like that because I'm terrible at English idioms.
You don't know your language.
No, I'll mix it up with a French one.
Yes.
And I'll it will sound English, but it will be French.
Right.
Like I've got my arse full of noodles.
Huh? That's a French idiom.
It is, yeah. It means that you're very lucky in life. You go, oh, he's got an arse full of noodles. Il a le cul bordé de nouilles.
Okay.
And that means that he's just very lucky.
Why? What? Because every time, whenever you're hungry, you can just pull out a noodle and yum, yum, yum.
I don't know. I don't know why, where that comes from. I haven't looked it up.
If you think about it, I mean, that would, you know, as long as you wash the noodle first.
Oh, come on.
Well, it would be quite lucky. Just a constant source of food. You'd never go hungry. That is kind of lucky in a sense.
Yeah, and I'm sure as well, it probably exists in other languages as well. A similar sort of thing. Because there always is, every time I'm like, oh, this is a French idiom or an English idiom, and it's very strange, somebody will go, oh, in Spanish also there's a thing, like, or in Chinese we also have, I did a mini-series on my YouTube where I taught French people English swear words, and it was very quick, it was like 1 minute, bang, 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 and the last one I did was, I can't be arsed, as in, like, you can't be bothered to move your ass to do the thing that you want. And somebody was like, oh, in Russian, we have, I think it was Russian. I can't remember if it was Russian or Chinese. It was some obscure language that I don't know. And
they were like, they're not, to be fair, they're not obscure languages.
No, what I meant was obscure to my mind.
Lots of people know those languages.
Yeah, more people know Chinese than English, to be fair. And so they were like, yeah, we also have this expression, which means the same thing. Like you're too lazy to want to move your ass.
Right.
It was, and I thought, oh, okay. That's good. It's not only English that has that.
Yep. So there's guess the idiom. I've got an idioms dictionary here. I will thumb through it and pick out an idiom and define it.
Love it.
Tell me what it is.
Love it.
Okay. Then there's random accent. That's where you have to speak in a certain accent for a bit.
Okay, I thought that was going to be where you imitate an accent and I would have to guess.
We could do that too.
Because you're good at imitating accents.
But no, I thought that I would basically say that you've got to do a certain accent. Maybe I could tell you what the accent is without the listeners hearing, and then the audience have to guess which accent it is you're doing. We could do something like that.
Okay.
But be careful, watch out, because there are two culturally inappropriate ones.
Oh, God.
I won't tell you which ones they are, because listeners, you know, doing accents is fun and everything, but some accents you shouldn't do, because that's...
Unless you do them really, really, really well.
Unless you do them really, really, really well. But you've got to do them really, really well.
Yeah. You've got to do them so that the people from that country go, oh my God, that's such a good imitation.
Which accents do you think are culturally inappropriate to do, Paul?
I would say, off the top of my head, Chinese.
Mm-hmm.
Any African country.
Yeah. Indian.
Yeah, I think Indian is still a little bit on the, it's on the fence, isn't it?
No.
No, we can't do Indian accents anymore.
I think that, I don't think we've ever really been, it's never really been okay to do Indian accents. I know
that. Well, apparently it was, because in The Simpsons, the
Apu.
Yeah, for like decades was a white guy, and then he was like, no, I'm not doing it anymore.
But I mean, at least the character was was Indian. I don't know. Yeah, anyways.
Well, yeah, but if you're doing an imitation of an Indian,
true,
then you're being a character of an Indian, but you're not Indian.
Yeah, the actor, the voice actor.
I'm split between those things of like, I get it. Yeah. I obviously understand why it is culturally inappropriate. But at the same time, if you're it's the thing of like being an actor, like being an able-bodied actor playing a disabled character in a film.
Yeah.
And there's a big, you know, Bill Burr has a great joke about that. About, yeah, he's like, oh, when Bryan Cranston from Breaking Bad played a quadriplegic in the English remake of the French film Intouchable.
Yeah. A guy in a wheelchair who's paralyzed from the neck down.
Yeah, there was a lot of commotion about the fact that it was an able-bodied person. He's like, yeah, because that's called acting. He's like, if you got a quadriplegic playing a quadriplegic in a film, then that's just somebody else saying the words that somebody else wrote.
Yeah.
It's not acting. So, like, it's a very funny joke.
Bill Burr is amazing because he is able to do comedy about these very touchy subjects, and he's an excellent comedian, and he rides that line very well.
Yeah.
But then ordinary people, I mean, not that you're ordinary, but just like civilians, not on stage.
Yeah.
It's whenever we broach the subject, it just gets tricky. So watch out. There are two what I think are generally considered to be culturally inappropriate.
This is the 15-minute intro, by the way.
This is the 15-minute intro. It's unavoidable. Then we've also got guess the punchline.
Okay.
So I'll tell you the setup to a joke.
Oh.
And you have to try to guess the punchline.
I like it.
I might give you some clues. This probably won't be very funny.
Okay.
That bit. Okay. All right. So you've got numbers 1 to 50.
Okay. And we'll just go through them in a random order.
Yeah. And we probably won't do all 50, but that's okay. All right then. So I'll let you start. Pick a number between 1 and 50.
I'll do 34 because that's how old I am.
34. Okay. Already you've jumped on random accent.
Oh, God. Okay.
I don't know if you'll be able to do this or not, but okay. This is what I'm going to ask you to do. So the random accent for you today, and I don't know if this one is culturally inappropriate or not, but I don't know. Let's at least say the intention is not to be rude.
No, of course not.
It's just for fun.
It's just for fun.
So I'd like you to try and speak English with a Brazilian Portuguese accent.
Oh.
Can you do that? Do you know it?
I can do a bit of one. Have you got something that I can read? Is that your dad's book?
That's my dad's book.
Should I read a bit extract of your dad's book?
You can try. I don't know if that's going to be the right kind of text for you, but you can try my dad's book, which is all about walking in the park and seeing wildlife.
Right. So this one's about pigeons.
Okay, this is Paul. This is Paul talking about pigeons in a Brazilian Portuguese accent.
I like how it's so specific as well. It's not Portuguese Portuguese. It's
Brazilian Portuguese. Brazilian Portuguese. Yeah, it's a different beast.
I have to... Tá bom, muito bom. Eu falo português do Brasil. In my view, the pigeon family...
That's Russian.
No, it's not Russian. I've got to get into it. I've got to get like at least five phrases into it.
Okay.
All I know is that they add vowels after words. Yeah. Like, because my dad's called Steve. Yeah. His partner is Brazilian.
Yeah.
And so she calls him Stevie.
Yeah.
What's the other thing that she does as well?
Stevie Wonder.
Stevie Wonder, yeah. I'm just imitating her now. That's it. I'm imitating.
Yeah, yeah. Do that. Just do your dad's partner.
But I've got to do it in the my view. In the my view, the pigeon family is often... I can't do it. It's underrated. No, it's too much. Too good English, the book.
The only things that I could do in a Brazilian Portuguese...
I can speak Portuguese in Brazilian Portuguese.
Yeah, that's good.
Eu falo português, tudo bom? Estou aqui na casa de Luque.
You can speak Portuguese?
A little bit. I mean, I studied it for a year, and it's very similar to Spanish. Very.
Really?
So...
There are certain words that sound great. For me, I mean, that I enjoy saying in a Brazilian Portuguese accent.
Go on.
Can you say the word internet?
Internet?
Yeah, it's like that. Internet.
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 Yeah.
Yeah. And anything with an ED ending. So yeah. Watched would be like watched.
Yeah.
And
I watched your show on the internet.
Exactly. Yeah. 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 Anyway.
Is that an echo coming from the inside of your guitar?
There is the yes. I've got a guitar on the wall. And yes, the sound will be bouncing out. Like, ha, the guitar is singing to us while we're talking. Is. Yeah.
It's very poetic.
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 Poetic. It's very poetic.
I love it. It's so, like, I much prefer the Brazilian Portuguese accent to the Portuguese Portuguese accent.
Yeah.
Because the Portuguese Portuguese accent, even when they speak Portuguese, mm-hmm. sounds to me like Spanish with a Russian accent. It's
That's
like,
good.
Because they cut off of the end of the words.
Uh-huh.
You know, like a... I'm looking at a word, like I'm looking at stuff that's got stuff
just,
written on it.
Just say Luke's English podcast.
Yeah,
Luke's English podcasty.
Yeah. It's more like, what's a Portuguese word? Like a, it's just Portugal. Portugal.
Portugal.
Portugal. Portugal. It sounds Russian.
Brazilians, we love you, okay?
Love and Portuguese as well.
Mimicry is the sincerest form of flattery. I don't know who said that. Well, you just said it now. Okay, so that was number 34, Paul. Okay. I don't know whether you passed or failed. We will let the audience decide.
I will now pick another one.
Yes, please.
39, because that's my wife's age.
39. Okay, Thomas Edison once said, genius is 1% perspiration. Wait a minute.
1% perspiration.
Genius is 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration.
Oh.
Do you agree? He also invented the light bulb. Do you agree with that too? Light bulbs, I mean. Do you agree with
light bulbs? Do I agree with light bulbs? Yeah.
No, so basically, do you agree with the statement that genius is 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration? We could apply this to other things, maybe success or... just, you know, work.
Yeah, in general, I wonder. I mean, success not necessarily depends what you mean by success because there's... Go on.
Can I just add something then? Let's say, like, genius is a big word. Let's just say work that you are proud of, work that you've done that you feel was a success. Let's say it's a piece of stand-up, a stand-up bit of yours that you have worked on and that always works. That's a really good bit that you like a lot.
What, you mean all my bits don't work like
well,
that?
Well, no, all of them, yeah, but I'm just asking. No,
yeah, I do agree with that sentiment, though, that a lot of... Yeah, I 100%. I mean 99%, I guess. But yeah, I think 1% is like this thing of like, oh, this is a thing, and then executing it is the most difficult part, and often the part that specifically with stand-up people don't see. And so when they see you on stage, they think, wow, this guy's just on stage, or this girl's just on stage talking, and it seems like we're in a pub. That's because they've spent hundreds and thousands of hours at comedy clubs where people don't laugh at those jokes. And having to deal with that, whereas that one time, so the 1% is like, I've got this good idea for a joke about the French language. Let me say it, and you say it 1,000 times on stage, it doesn't go well, and 1,001st time, you're like, oh, that I've found it now, and then from then on, that's what people go, oh, well, that's an easy joke, and so yeah, and that's for comedy, but I think for a lot of things, like whether it's like creative projects as well. I think like songs I'm thinking about, like you write a song, like that you have the idea, you have a lyric that inspires a song, and then you have to write the rest of the lyrics, you have to write the music. Yeah, I think so. I definitely agree with that. I don't know if it's 99% and 1%, but it's definitely more percent in the actual doing it, because I think probably a lot of people in life have amazing creative ideas, but they just don't ever put them, they never actually make them or do them, and so they never get made.
Yeah, discipline, hard work, determination.
But when you say success, the thing that went to my mind was like Instagram people who just show their asses on Instagram, and or if they're dudes like working out at the gym, they take a photo like, and then it gets. I mean, they have to do it a lot.
You mean literal perspiration?
Yeah, literal perspiration. Yeah, exactly.
Actually sweating in a gym.
Yeah,
I think the Instagram models who take pictures of their bums, I think that actually they work pretty hard. You know, they probably spend all morning like taking photos until they get that one photo.
Yeah,
where
that's true.
Where the angle is just right, the lighting is just right, so it looks like they haven't spent all morning on
yeah,
it.
Yeah, and then not even that. Like they'll take a million photos and then they have to go and edit them. And then not only that, when you post it, what format do you post it? What are the tags? What are the hashtags? You have to look. So yeah, fair enough. Like even that on a surface level, yeah, it takes a lot of work to do anything that. You know, when people say overnight success,
yeah,
it's often many, many years in the making.
Yes, that's right. I say it says genius, but it also could be things like talent. Like the 1% could just be talent, or the smaller percentage could be talent, but you still got to work on it. That's the point. Probably true in language learning too. But the other question is, do you agree with light bulbs?
Do I agree with them?
It's a strange question, I know.
I prefer LED panels.
Really? Why?
Well, just because they're less hot, they consume less energy, and they're more powerful.
More powerful than you
I mean, obviously the original bulb meant that we were able to see stuff in the dark.
Yeah, thanks Edison, thanks Tom.
Can you imagine Edison? In England, otherwise we'd have, what, 5 hours of daylight?
Oh, yeah.
At this time of year?
We'd never get anything done.
But I guess back in the day, they used candles, which was before the light bulb.
Gas. Okay, thank you very much for that.
That was a good one.
Let me just cross that one out on my list here. Cross it off the old list. Okay, so another number then, please, Paul.
Oh, let's do 22.
22, here we go. So, what's your favourite YouTube channel or YouTube video?
Oh, that's a difficult one. It changes all the time. If you right now, my favourite YouTube channel... Oh, the one that I always watch a video of or that inspires me is a guy called Peter McKinnon, who is Canadian. Mm-hmm. He is a filmmaker photographer, but he's also funny. His videos are a lot of stuff around photography and video and cameras and all that kind of stuff. But it's also you can watch it if you're not a geek. Because he's funny and he's as the French would say, attachant. He's got a personality that you gravitate towards.
Engaging. He's engaging. He's magnetic. He's got a magnetic personality.
Yeah, he's very cool. So that's my favourite channel at the moment.
Peter McKinnon.
Yeah,
he's got 5.18 million subscribers. And his videos look very good indeed.
Yeah. I mean, he kind of inspires me. That's why my lives now look so good, is because I've watched so many of his videos about lighting techniques, about camera settings and all that kind of stuff.
Yes.
My favorite video.
Is there one video on YouTube?
You know what I found? I found a video yesterday and I was like, whoa, this is cool. It was a version of Don't Look Back in Anger.
Yeah.
By Noel Gallagher and his band.
High Flying Birds.
Yeah, and his voice is amazing in this video. Yeah, it's really good. I don't know if you can put... I guess on a podcast, you're allowed, aren't you, to put like songs and stuff?
Well, if it go, you know, as we know, as I said at the beginning of the episode, that I do put the audio onto YouTube too, and often they
get panned, yeah. Just on the podcast, does that...
It should be all right, but...
It just gets demonetized usually on YouTube.
On YouTube it does. You kind of tend to get away with it a bit more. But we could maybe play a little bit.
History. It'll be in my most recent... And I was like, wow, I've never heard this version. And his voice is incredible.
Don't look back in anger, I heard you say...
It's a lot less... You'll hear it. Hold on, let me... I don't know how loud this is.
Sounds good.
Does it sound good on your side? Hold on, let me.
It sounds more like the Stones. Adding Paul McCartney bass lines to it. Step outside, cause summertime. Stand out beside the fireplace and take that look from off your face. Cause you ain't never gonna bear my heart. Sally can wait. She knows it's too late. She's walking up. Okay, lovely. Yeah, I had to. I felt like I had to sort of put something on top. You know, talking.
Yeah.
Just because that, you know, that
the algorithm,
the guidelines, the rules.
Well, although that's good. The interesting thing about that one is it's not. It's a video that's been posted by a person called Godlike Genius.
Oh,
and so it's not. I mean, it was filmed on Channel 4. So I'm sure Channel 4 will come down and be like, hey, this thing. But yeah, that was a video that I saw yesterday. And I listened to it. I was like, oh, God, that reminds me of, I don't know, just my youth.
It's a great song.
And it's a great song. And it was just a nice remix. So that's, I mean, it's not my favorite video, but it's just one that I saw yesterday. Favorite video. Yeah, I don't know.
Okay, that's good. You passed. Well done. You get another point. That's 3 points. You've got 3 points so far.
Oh, this is a point. I didn't realize this.
No, there.
We're doing points.
Well, yeah, why not? I mean, go on. Yeah, so you got 3 points.
Who am I playing against?
Yourself. You got 3 points out of a total possible number of 3. So you've nice. Got 100%.
I'm doing
so
well. I'm doing well.
Okay, another number then, please, Paul.
Let's do. How many are there?
There are 50 in total.
Let's do 50.
Number 50, citizenship test. Oh, this is another category. You can see how prepared...
I'm going to fail, for sure.
You can see how prepared I am. So this is another category, which is citizenship test. And this is where
French or English?
The English one.
British, I should say.
British. Yeah, well, it'll probably be English soon. English and Welsh as well, maybe. We'll see. Okay, so you get the idea, right? Just a random question from a British citizenship test.
Yeah.
Actually, the first part of this test is, can you say British citizenship test?
British citizenship test.
Okay, good. You didn't say shit.
No, I almost did, though.
Yeah, British citizenship. If you were Sean Connery.
A British citizenship test.
British citizenship test. Okay, all right.
God bless his soul.
This is a good question. Random question. Yeah. What is the capital city of Northern?
Northern.
What's the capital city of Northern Ireland?
Northern. That'll be Belfast, so it would.
It is, so it is. Belfast. You're not wrong.
Not wrong, no.
Okay.
Big man.
Belfast. Sure enough. Cracker Eye, Belfast. It's the capital city of Northern Ireland, so it is. Capital city of Northern Ireland, so it is. Hi, Nye, Brian Coy.
Hi, Nye, Brian.
How you are, Nye?
Have you spent an hour in the power shower recently? Is that you that spent an hour in the power shower?
You know how posh people say power shower?
In what? In
posh,
Ireland?
Super posh people in England.
Oh, in England.
How do they say power shower? Par shower.
A par shower.
I spent an hour in the par shower.
I spent an hour in the par shower.
Okay, so...
At my gap year.
Exactly. Okay, that was citizenship test number. That was number 50.
Oh, and I got it. Okay,
you passed. You got another point. Well done. Okay, next. Another question, please.
0 to 50. Let's do, in the small numbers, let's do number 7.
Number 7. Okay, question number 7 is this. Have you ever had a fight with someone? What happened? If not, and also who won? And if you haven't ever had a fight with someone, what's the closest you've ever been to having a fight with someone?
All right, the closest I've ever been, because I've not really ever been in a proper fight, was the one that always springs to mind is I was driving in Paris. So that's already a good start because you know that it's going to go south very quickly.
It's going to get aggressive.
It's going to get aggressive. Driving in Paris and I was leaving my house, and the way the road, this specific crossroads was set up, is that if you want to turn left, you have to wait for the oncoming traffic to stop because the lights are green for... there's two sets of green lights. Let me start again.
The oncoming traffic? That's traffic that's not coming?
The oncoming traffic. Right, did I say oncoming?
I thought you did.
I meant oncoming.
Listeners, rewind the podcast and just tell me if I'm wrong. But yeah, anyway, start again.
The lights are green. Yes. In one direction, yeah. And then the lights are green in the other. It's not like four different lights, in the sense that when you move forward, the people in front of you move forward as well.
Yeah, okay.
In the opposite direction. Sometimes, like in the US...
Well, and then everyone just crashes into each other.
No, sometimes you've got one out of the four crossroads, one of them is green. So that means only one of the four quadrants moves.
Wait a minute. There's four roads. They all meet together in a square.
Yeah.
So you're saying that in some cases, only one of those roads is allowed to go
green. Intelligent people that do city planning well,
yes,
it means that if you're driving, then it means you can either go straight, you can turn right, or you can go left. And you're green. But while you do that, one else is moving.
Right, I see.
And then it's the turn of the person to the group to the right. They do the same thing. Mm-hmm. In France, it's difficult to explain. You move while the people in front of you move towards you.
And the idea is that they pass each other. Yeah. And if you need to turn left, you kind of wait until there's a gap. And
exactly.
Similarly,
So I had to turn left.
Most of the time they're like that. In the
UK, maybe, yeah. Because our city planning is terrible. Anyway, I needed to turn left, which meant that I needed to wait for the oncoming traffic to stop.
Yeah.
But while I was waiting for that, I was blocking everyone behind me because the street isn't wide enough. There's only one lane.
They can't get around you while you're waiting to
turn
left.
Exactly. So that's why this is why I'm saying poor city planning.
Yes.
Right? Because fair enough, in England, you both oncoming traffic and you are moving, but if you want to turn left, you move into a separate lane so that everyone can keep going past
you. But that wasn't possible in this case.
So everyone was behind me. Yeah. There was a guy who was getting very angry. He was a taxi driver. Was he a taxi driver? I think he was a taxi driver. And I could
Robert
see
De Niro.
Him, yeah, I could see him in my rearview mirror just getting so anxious, like, like, I'm like, what? I can't do anything. So in between the driver's seat and the passenger seat, there's a gap. And I put my middle finger up, like backwards, pointing towards him.
Giving him the
giving the old finger.
I think it's called the fuck you. Is that right? No, I don't know.
I don't know. But I was saying fuck you with my finger.
Right.
Inside the car. Like, I didn't stick it out of the window and put it above. It was in the middle of the... And I could see him. I know I could see that he saw it. And he was going ape. He was going crazy in his car. Like, So anyway, the traffic eventually... the oncoming traffic stopped. I turned left.
Yeah.
And then he turned left with me and was like really up my ass, like really close. Like, just, he was so angry. And then we got to a red light about 200 meters further down. He got out of his car. Ooh. Yeah. I was like, oh God, here we go. So he got out of his car. My doors were locked and he starts banging on the window and I'm ignoring him. Like, I'm pretending that there's nothing happening. I'm just like, and inside of me, I'm going, oh God, here we go. Here we go. Here we go. This is going to go bad. So he's banging on the door. He's like banging on the window. And I drop the window by like 2 centimeters, not enough for him to get in a hand in or anything. And he's like, allez, quoi? Hey! He's like shouting at me in French, right? And basically in French, he's so angry. And he's like, was that to me? Were you doing that to me? Was that you that was, you were doing that to me? What was that? Was that me? Are you talking to me? This is me.
You're talking to me.
Yeah.
You're talking to me. He was Robert De Niro.
You're talking to me. He was so angry. He's like, this is me. And I was like, was that you? Were you doing that to me? And I just went, no. And he goes, oh, okay. And he just walked back to his taxi. And the light was green and I drove off and then he carried on. I'm like, oh God, that would have quickly... What if I'd have said yes? It'd have probably smashed my window and grabbed me by the throat or something. It was just so funny how quickly it de-escalated.
Yeah, just like, no, it wasn't me. Oh, okay, sorry, bye. Yeah.
Some of the best road rage videos are... there's like a really funny road rage...
compilation
In the UK
of just people swearing, like people driving when they've got dash cams and then they see terrible driving and they're like, are you fucking Muppet? And stuff like that. It's wonderful
just
video.
People getting really I fucking cunt, you fucking
it's like really good examples of English people swearing at each other in cars. You got 1 point again.
Nice.
I've no idea how many points you got. I think you got 5 points now.
Okay.
Well, you're doing really well.
I'm doing all right.
5 points. No one's ever got 5 points before. No one's ever played this game before. But
all right, let's do...
It's a new world record, Paul. Another number, please.
Let's do number 16, because your poster that I'm looking at is the Beatles in Paris on the 16th of January to the 4th of February 1964. Although that wasn't actually them, was it?
What?
They were opening act for somebody.
No. 1964, they probably were the headline act.
Were they?
I don't know, probably.
Oh, maybe it was their first time at the Olympia in Paris, like wasn't actually them performing.
What?
It wasn't, they weren't the headline gig, but they were, I think, there's something about that poster where it's not, because I looked it up.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So I've got a poster on my wall, listeners. It says The Beatles in Paris in French, Les Beatles à Paris. And it says from the 16th of January to the 4th of February, 1964. So I expect they played a few different gigs at the Olympia, which is a famous venue. You've performed at the Olympia.
I have performed twice, not my full show, but just... Mm-hmm. 10-minute bits.
So we're now speculating about whether or not they were the headline act.
They probably were, but I remember reading something about that poster. All right, Live the Olympia. From this day until the 4th of February, the Beatles performed 18 days of concerts at Paris's Olympia on a 9-act bill, playing 2 and sometimes 3 sets each day. The Beatles closed each performance but shared top billing at various times with French singer Sylvie Vartan or America's Trini Lopez. They had just 2 days off on the run, the 28th. Yes, yeah, so there was 9 people on the bill, so I guess they were only doing a couple of songs.
But they, the Beatles never did more than about 25 minutes.
Really?
And almost all of their shows were about maximum 30 minutes long.
Really? They never did like a full concert?
No, they would. No, in those days, it was very rare to do like an hour or 2 hours. That was not until later. I mean, you know, this is back in the very, very early days before rock concerts didn't even really exist. You know, they just they invented it all. So, yeah, instead you'd have these kind of more like old-fashioned shows where you get 9 acts, each one of them doing 10 or 15 minutes, and then the headline act does about 30 minutes at the end.
So that's why they're on the poster, because no one cared about the 7 other or the 8 other acts. Because now it's you have an opening act and the main act, or maybe 2 opening acts and the main act. Mm-hmm. That's interesting.
Yeah, that's right.
The songs that they performed were From Me to You, Roll Over Beethoven, She Loves You, This Boy, Boys, I Want to Hold Your Hand, Twist and Shout, and Long Tall Sally.
Okay.
That was their set list.
Classic 1964 set list from the Beatles.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anyway, so 16 is
number 16 is Guess the Idiom.
Oh!
Okay, so I'm now going to reach over onto into my bookshelf here and find an idioms dictionary. I'm going to go for this one. This is just the one that's closest to hand. This is the Oxford Dictionary of English Idioms. Volume 2, I think. And this is a bit of an old edition. Just to put this in context, this was published in 1993. But I think the language hasn't changed that much in that time. So random page. Let me just pick a nice one. Okay, hold on a minute. Okay, so this is an idiom that we would use as a way of saying stay attentive. Let's say you're in the car, for example, and
keep your eyes on the road.
Could be, but not right. You're in the car and you're telling passengers that you want them to look out for a specific road sign, for example, the turning to get off the, you know, to get onto the M42. You know, you're looking for junction 6, the turning for junction 6 at
keep
the
keep your M4. Eye out.
Well, so what? How do you tell the passengers to stay attentive so that they can
watch out?
It involves the eyes, and it's like, don't shut
your eye on the ball.
That's also good, but it's not right. Basically, don't shut your eyes. Keep your eyes open.
Keep your eyes open.
So what do you do with an orange?
Keep your eyes peeled.
Yes.
There we go.
Keep your eyes peeled, which is a way of saying keep looking. For example...
God, there's so many ways keep your eye out. That's what we would normally say.
Yeah.
That's me growing up. Like, keep your eye out.
My dad would definitely say, keep your eyes peeled. It just reminds me of being in the car with my dad when I was a kid. Like, he would constantly be telling us to keep our eyes peeled. It's one of those dad phrases.
Yeah.
Keep your eyes peeled.
I like the visual of that, though. If you open your eye, it's kind of like peeling back the orange. Yeah.
Keep your eyes peeled. Yeah. Okay. There you go.
Oh, that's
was.
Half a point.
Did you got it, though, eventually?
I did get it.
You get a point.
All right, good. This is going well.
You got 6 points.
I wish all game stories were like this.
You're doing so well, Paul. This is amazing. Okay, another number then, please.
Let's do 4, since that poster from this... Go on, no?
No, I was going to jump in with a bonus question.
Go on.
Which is, where is Amber?
Where is Amber? It's a good point. Is this a genuine question?
Yeah, no, yes, it is a genuine question. Okay. I'm asking that for the benefit of the audience. So I've just realised we haven't explained her absence. They'll be thinking,
no, we talked
minute.
About it at the beginning.
Well, we said that she wasn't here, but we didn't say why.
She's. I presume she's at home with her baby, because she doesn't have childcare for the second baby. But we've been trying... How long have you been trying to get the two of us together?
Just ages.
It's been months where you've like, oh, can we do it? And Amber is only really available on evenings. Something like that, wasn't it? Because then the baby's asleep.
It's just hard to explain, but yeah, it's
just when you become a parent, your life your anything that's not looking after your baby or going, taking them, dropping them off from school, like everything has to be planned around that.
Yeah, exactly. And she's just not that available because she's the primary caregiver for her child, yeah. Of course. So we'll find a way. We'll find a way to get her back on the podcast. The other thing also is that in the evenings, potentially we could do
Should I try and call her and get her like for 2 seconds?
Yeah,
on the podcast?
On. Yeah.
Amber Minogue.
Another way we could do it is maybe to do it online, you know, on Zoom or something like that. But that even that's difficult because of other reasons. Anyway, Paul's calling Amber. I wonder what's going to happen here.
Can you hear that?
Yeah, I can hear that. You going to talk to her?
Yeah.
Is she going to pick up? I bet she doesn't pick up. She's like, Paul, no thanks.
It is kind of 5 o'clock, so it's probably prime time.
It's probably baby
not
sleeping.
Being able to pick up the phone time.
Yeah. She's like, why is Paul calling me now? Doesn't he know that I'm breastfeeding my child?
Please don't leave me a message. Rather send me an email or a text message. Merci de vous pas laisser un message.
I love that. Oh, hello, this is Amber. Fuck off.
Amber, hello. It's Paul Taylor. I'm sat here with Luke Thompson in his house, and we're recording a podcast because he's on my live later on, and we decided to ask tell the listeners why you weren't here, and we were going to call you to see what was going on. However, your voicemail is amazing. Hi, this is Amber. Fuck off.
This is Amber. Please don't leave me a message. In fact, just don't call me again.
All right, if you call back in the next 10 minutes, we're still here. If not, then we'll see you later. Bye. There you go. She's going to get that message and just be like, what is going on?
I wonder
on?
If she's going to call us back. Keep your eyes peeled.
I will keep my eyes peeled. Oh, bringing it back to the game.
Okay, so you said number 4.
Yeah.
Okay, because of the Beatles poster.
4th of February.
16th of January to the 4th of February. Okay, question number 4. Do you fancy learning any new languages? You already speak French. You kind of speak English. And you you speak Spanish as well. You know, would you like to learn another language?
I don't know, really. Yes and no. It's just so much effort. And I don't know what I would do with it. Like, as I get older, I'm just like, I don't do things that don't serve a purpose. And like, I don't know, I'm just, the English in me is just pragmatic, mm-hmm. being like, oh well, if I do this, then this must give this result. If I were to learn another language, it would be probably Mandarin. Yeah, just
not Mandarin
then. Mandarin or Mandarin, I don't know.
Mandarin, Mandarout. Anyway, Mandarin. Anyway, go on.
The language spoken in China.
Yes.
Or most of it.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I feel like it would be the most, like, it's the one of the, you know, it, I mean, it's only spoken there, so it's kind of, unless I was going to China, what would be the point? But I think it would be, it's. I mean, it's just useful to have, I think.
Yeah. Do you speak any Mandarin at all at this point?
Ni hao.
Yeah.
And champion.
Champion?
Champion.
Right, champion, that's it. A lovely cup of tea, that was champion.
Yeah, champion means product.
Oh, does it?
Yeah, like, because I used to do Apple trainings often, and I would always, so there was two things that would often come up, and as English speakers and with the American team, we were like, "Oh, I wonder what that means." The first one was champion, because
wait a minute. So they're all going blah 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 champion blah 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 blah.
Exactly.
Like, wait a minute, what's champion?
Yeah. Champion. I mean, I'm obviously pronouncing it not correctly, but to English ears, mm-hmm. it sounded like champion, and it turned out that it meant product. So when they were practicing giving their presentations, they'd be like, "Oh, and this product is very good." They'd be like, "Blah blah blah, champion, blah 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 blah." Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And you're like, "Oh, that's weird." And the other one is a more controversial, a very controversial one that became controversial this year with what happened with George Floyd and the brutal police killings and the racist stuff, because there were in Chinese, there's a filler word, like instead of going mm-hmm. The word that they use to English ears sounds
like George. And so I went to the bank, George Floyd, and I wanted to get some money, George Floyd.
No, but if you were to,
sorry, Black Lives Matter. Oh God. What did I just do? I'm sorry.
You're going to get cancelled.
I know. Exactly.
Hashtag cancel Luke Thompson.
No, don't. Please. No, please. Leave me alone.
So the N-word.
Yeah, the N-word.
The N-word is a filler word in Mandarin.
Seriously? Right. Well, I'm not going to start riffing on that now, Paul.
No, that's why I didn't say it, because you're not, I mean, it's weird to say it, and I don't speak Cantonese or China, or Mandarin, sorry. But yeah, the filler word that they use quite often sounds like the N-word in English, and there was a whole controversy about, I think it was a teacher or some Chinese YouTuber or TikTok personality that used the word, and obviously everyone in America went crazy. Everyone. A lot of people went crazy saying this guy's a racist. Like, no, it's you don't speak Mandarin.
Yeah.
So you didn't understand that this word means is a filler word. It sounds like what you think it sounds like, but it's not it. Anyway, there was a whole massive kerfuffle.
Oh, dear. Okay. Well.
Where some poor Chinese, I think it might have been a teacher.
They got cancelled.
Somebody was going to get cancelled. Yeah, I don't know.
Oh, listeners, Chinese listeners, we love you. Okay, just in case you
just be careful when you go to the US and you speak amongst yourselves.
I'm sure that most of the time it's all right, but just this one particular TikTok video which went viral is probably an issue. But anyway, listeners, shall I give Paul a point for that? Yeah, why not? Me, on the other hand, I don't get any points, but I think that you would you get a point for wanting to learn Mandarin, even though you're not actually doing it.
Oh, Amber Minogue's calling back.
Okay.
Here we go.
Amber to the rescue.
Amber Minogue.
Amber's on the podcast.
Hello, did you listen to my voicemail?
No, I never listened to voicemail.
Oh, so she doesn't know. She doesn't
you don't know. Amber, you don't know.
Just for your information, Amber and Paul are on another podcast.
What?
You're on the podcast. You're on Luke's English podcast right now.
How exciting. Live on the podcast.
we were just talking about your voicemail message, and we think it's very funny. It's basically like, hello, you've reached Amber Minogue. Don't leave me a message. In fact, just don't call me back, please.
I don't want to listen to messages. I'm like, just send me a text message. I'm not interested.
Clearly.
And then people are like, I left your message. I'm like, I didn't get it because I don't listen to it.
I have a similar voicemail message, which is, hi, my name's Paul. If I don't have your number in my phone, then I'm not calling you back unless you leave me a message or send me a text message, because I don't call people. Like, I get too many calls from unknown numbers. If I don't know you, I'm not calling you back.
I mean, you actually have a good reason. Not that many people actually call me. I'm just really grumpy, really mean and sort of awful person. But I'm just like, it's just too much effort. I can spend all day scrolling around, but just too much effort to listen to a voicemail.
Amber, why are you not on the podcast in the full physical sense today?
Because you didn't invite me.
Well, to be fair,
I've been trying to
invite you for ages, but yes, this was more of a sort of off the cuff thing actually today. He says, digging himself out of a hole.
Luke's on my live show today at 10 p.m. in the studio, and since it's like a 10-minute walk away, I was like, if you wanted to do a podcast, I can come round before. He's like, oh yeah, cool. But yeah, we were saying that we've been trying to get the three of us on for ages, and I was coming up with reasons why you're not on it, and it was to do with childcare in my memory.
Well, basically, yes. I mean, if you want to have my daughter shouting on the podcast, then bring me on. But basically, she spends her life just like just shouting. I was trying to do a voiceover today. I've been trying to do it since 7 in the morning. Just, I keep being like, we can hear something in the background. I'm like, is it a baby screaming? But yeah, I have no childcare. I'm crossing my fingers, because I'm going through they have like this special assembly, this private meeting a few times a year, and then they just decide who is going to get one of the golden places in the creche. And I'm going to find out next week if I've got one. I'm holding my breath.
I should tweet them. I should go, hey, by the way, you should give the place to Amber Minogue, and they'll be like, who are you? But yeah, all right, fair
yeah,
enough.
Yeah, let's hope you get the place in creche so that you get rid of your daughter. No, that's not what I mean. so that you can come back on the podcast. Yes.
I mean, yes, exactly. That's exactly what I want. But no, I love my daughter, but I really, really want her to get a place in creche.
It's like all parents. It's like, yeah, we have a baby, but we don't want them all the time. We just want them
not all the time. time.
Part of the time.
We just want to have them when we want to have them. So
when it's convenient for us.
They could just be asleep or being looked after by someone else until we just want to be with them. Then that would be best, please. Thank you.
Yeah, exactly. I need some more professional. She needs more professional care. I'm sure they'd be doing it better than me.
Wow.
Your Gute? Yes, what would you like for Gute? This is child number one, desperate for Gute.
Child one wants food, snacks.
Give me food.
He wants snacks. He lives for snacks. All he wants is snacks. He's a snack monster. Well, listen, enjoy toast. Yes.
Toast.
The yummy toast. Okay, the yummy toast with butter. There we go. I have my orders. Yes, I definitely want to come back on the podcast. Hopefully I'll get some childcare. But listen, enjoy yourself, you guys. Are you doing something crazy? What's your theme this week?
We are doing random questions. That's where I've got 50 questions and stupid little challenges, and Paul has to name a number, and then I ask him a question, like he has to do a stupid accent or answer a citizenship test question and things like that. And he's doing very well. He's got something like 8 points already, which
Excellent.
It's a new 50. World record. Yeah, well, we won't do all 50 of them.
Luke podcast style, I'd have chosen 50. I mean, most people would have gone with 10.
Yeah, and we'll get through 7.
Two, three,
some
four,
long detours,
five,
all around.
6, 7. You've got 7 points so far.
Nice.
But I think, Lennon. Yes. All right, Amber, lovely to hear from you and your lovely voice.
Oh, thank you, Luke and Paul. I can't wait to see you. Maybe soon.
Yeah,
maybe
hopefully.
Yes. Yes, come back on the podcast when it's possible.
All right, then. Take care.
Okay.
All right, see you later.
Bye.
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 Okay, that was what, question number... Oh, we haven't done the question yet. Have we? Did you name a number?
Maybe I didn't. Let's do...
Yeah, okay. Well, come on. Give me another number.
Let me do... I've done the 30. It's 40. Let's do 40, 40, 43?
43.
42. Because 42 is the meaning of life, isn't it?
The answer to life, the universe and everything is 42. We just don't know what the question is.
Oh, okay, that's it.
Okay, Paul Taylor, what is your preferred mode of transport and why?
Oh, that's an interesting one. I think it will depend. So up until about a month ago, it was scooter, meaning moped.
Electric.
Electric. I mean, it doesn't matter if it's electric or not, just like a motorbike situation for Paris, because it's just easier to get around traffic, you get to places quicker. But when it gets cold and rainy, it's not ideal. And so I've now I'm back to the car for a while until it gets hot again. I'd say that's probably my favorite in Paris. I do like, I've got a one wheel, which is kind of cool, which is like an electric skateboard snowboard type thing, which is has a one wheel. It's like standing on a skateboard, but there's a big wheel in the middle. And it auto balances. It's kind of like a gyroscope thing. It's not the one wheel that you put in between your legs and you stand on the side of the wheel. It's like a, because you're facing forward on those things.
Yeah.
This one, you're facing sideways,
like a skateboard.
And it's just fun to get around. It's more complicated in Paris because the roads are really bumpy and it's not amazingly smooth. But yeah.
Okay. There you go. So, wait a minute.
Or a plane. A plane is like a long distance flight. I love long distance flights because it's where I think I wrote most of my first show and most of my first ideas came from, was taking a long haul flight to the US about 6 times a year. It's like a 12-hour flight to San Francisco, and my phone doesn't work because it's on, there's nothing coming in. There's no social media.
Yeah.
There's no one hassling me. There's no emails that are coming through, and I usually don't have enough organization to put a film on there before. So sometimes I'd watch a film on the plane, but often that the screen didn't work, something didn't work. And so I'd just be in my own brain for 12 hours and I enjoyed that.
And you just sit and write ideas and stuff.
Yeah, or just think about stuff, just general idea stuff, how it'd be brainstorming with myself, being like, oh, and that I still have that, but it's less time and it's in the shower now. In the 10 minutes that I'm in the shower,
12 hours has been reduced to 10 minutes.
Yeah, exactly. So that's probably why I'm in this struggle part of my life and career where I'm like, I don't really know what I'm doing anymore because I don't have enough brain space to think about it. Because, you know, at least when I was flying, I mean, when I used to work for Apple, I didn't have the career where people would call me all the time. And even if they did, the excuse was I'm on the flight and I'll see you when I get there. Whereas now it's like, I can't just not pick up the phone. I'm like, well, what were you doing? Nothing. I was just sitting, reflecting. It's very difficult. It's almost unacceptable to the... But as an artist, normally it's like, oh, he's rented a house in the countryside and he spent 3 months there in solitary confinement to think about his new album.
But you just get 10 minutes in the shower.
Yeah.
At least you're clean.
Yeah.
I can confirm, listeners, he doesn't smell. So that's...
There we go.
You know, you've got to look on the bright side of these things sometimes.
Always look on the bright side.
Let's do three more of these.
All right, three more.
I think, listeners, am I right? Has Paul got 8 points? And everyone's going, we're not counting, Luke.
And we don't care.
I know, but I maintain the point system. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7... I think it's 8. Oh, I can't count anymore. Oh, never could anyway. Right, so number. Paul is looking around the room, looking for
inspiration.
Inspiration for numbers.
You've got une petite mousse magnet on there. Oh, that's cool.
Une petite mousse is a brewery, a beer brewery that provides Paul with free beer.
Yeah, although I'll have to buy some for the show tonight because I don't have any left.
And I've got some beer in the fridge if you want.
I don't know. Let's pick a number. Let's do 20. Let's do let's do 30. No, I've already done quite a lot on the 30s. 20. All right, let's do 26 because that was the year that I started doing comedy.
This is quite appropriate because number 26, the question is, what's your favorite kind of beer?
Oh, there we go. This is really, it depends again on the situation. My favorite beer just to drink in general would probably be, like an IPA type beer. One that has a bit of taste to it.
Yeah.
But it's not too strong.
A sort of hoppy, citrusy IPA.
Yeah, I like that. However, having said that, if I know that, I'm going out with friends or I'm going to a pub and it's in England or I'm going out and I haven't eaten a lot, a Guinness, gotta have a Guinness. I love, it's just a Guinness now and again. Oh, it just does it for me. I really like it.
Especially sort of in the UK, I'm sure even more so in Ireland, I'm certain. But in the UK, it's often draft Guinness is pretty good.
Yeah.
They say that Guinness doesn't travel, meaning the further away you get from the point of origin of the beer, the worse it is. So if you're drinking Guinness in, I don't know, like somewhere in France, for example, it's not as good as it would be if it was in Ireland or even in England.
Apparently.
Yeah, that's what they say.
I do feel like it has a bit more of a, like a metally taste sometimes on tap when you have it in France. I had one a few months ago in a pub here. So that's that for that occasion. Also, though, I do kind of just like normal piss, standard lager beer,
cooking lager.
Yeah, like when it's really hot outside and you're at the beach or whatever. And I don't do well in. My wife loves the beach, but I just don't like when we met in the summer down south where it was really hot at our the house that we'd rented on Airbnb for a couple of weeks. I didn't mind drinking normal like standard Carlsberg or Heineken or 16, like any basic lager, just because it's refreshing.
Yes.
So it depends. But if I had a beer right now in front of me, one of my favorite brands is BrewDog, the Scottish. I just like the taste of them. They do come in a can though, which is controversial.
They sell them in bottles as well.
Do they?
There's the
they do, don't they?
BrewDog Punk IPA is probably the one you're talking about.
Yeah, the blue.
Yeah, so I quite like them too. Mm. Yes, okay. Interesting. For me, it's strength, alcohol percentage, alcohol content makes a big difference. And I don't like it to be too strong.
Yeah, right.
Anything above, well, I prefer my optimal strength for beer is like between 4 and 5%.
Oh, really? That low?
Yeah, that low, yeah. Whereas in France, I find that beer just so often is much
it's
too
at
strong.
At least 5 here, yeah.
Yeah, it's often too strong for
yeah,
me.
Yeah, if you get a Grimbergen or something, it's like 7% or
anything
something.
Above 6, it's just like, this is ridiculous. This is wine. This isn't beer. This is just fizzy wine.
I would say in general, Belgian beers I'm a fan of. I cannot drink a lot of them, though, because otherwise the next day, like I'm vomiting heavily the next. I don't know what this. There must be an extra ingredient in Belgian beer, or that the ingredient is made in a certain
alcohol
way. Yeah, but it's not that. I mean, I can drink wine. I could drink a bottle of wine, no problem, or two bottles of wine for myself.
Really?
I mean, I'd be rough the next day, but I'd never be as if I drank that same amount of Belgian beer, which is less alcohol in percentage wise.
Mm-hmm.
it'd be finished.
You'd be rat-arsed.
Rat-arsed. Shit-faced.
A comment has just come in. I've just got a notification. A comment has just come in on my YouTube channel.
Oh, yeah?
And it's Quang Nguyen.
Yes.
Who 2 minutes ago on YouTube typed, "Oh, my God." No. "Oh, God, I can't believe it's been 3 years already." And this is a comment on episode 436, which was called "The Return of the Lion Game with Paul Taylor and Amber Minogue."
Oh, no way. And hold on. This isn't broadcasting live, is it?
No.
You're not, okay.
No, it's not live, but someone has just commented on an old episode, an old video on my YouTube channel.
Right.
And by coincidence,
it's one with...
It's a Paul and Amber episode.
Can
Amber
you do
Paul.
Live podcasts with your podcast server thing?
No, I
can't. Because on my Podbean, the thing that I ended up going with, contrary to everything that you were like, yeah, I don't know why, and I regret it now. But anyway, they've got like a live podcast thing where you can broadcast the podcast live.
Yeah, but live podcasts are not... they are a thing, but they're not... really established, not in the same way that YouTube Live or Twitch or whatever.
Right.
Okay, so there you go. Thank you for answering that question, Paul. You get another point. Well done.
Yeah.
Okay, so two more of these, and then we're going to call it a day.
Let's do... You pick one for me.
Okay.
Well, you know the numbers, so that's not fair, is it? But it doesn't matter. Go.
Okay, I'll just pick a number. I'm going to pick number 12. Guess the punchline.
Oh, we didn't do that one yet.
Okay, this is where I lean over and...
You're looking your crap dad jokes.
I've got a book of crap dad jokes, which was given to me, I think, by my wife, probably. So I'll just thumb through this book and see if I can find... something. Okay, I think the listeners might know this one, but I'm going to do it anyway. So why wouldn't they let the architect build a bungalow? Why wouldn't they let the architect build a bungalow? Just let me know if you need any clues.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, so something to do with his design. Something about his design.
Because it would be a flat design?
We're getting there.
Because it would fall flat?
Well, no. What is it about bungalows?
One story.
One story? Is there another word for stories?
What, one floor?
Floor. So, what were the problems with his design? There were too many floors.
Oh, there were too many floors.
There were too many floors in his design.
Oh, that's awful. I mean, that's pretty good, to be fair.
I quite like it.
Yeah, I like it as well.
Floors meaning first floor, second floor, third floor, but also floors meaning errors, issues, problems, mistakes, imperfections.
Yeah.
F-L-A-W-S.
Oh, that's good. That's a good one.
Let me give you another one.
Oh.
Some of the jokes in this book are genuinely crap. Some of them are not so bad. Okay, I'm going to keep...
People say, oh, it's a dad joke, often it's a good joke, but it's just so cheesy.
Yeah. But if you can get over the social stigma of a cheesy joke, there's a lot to be gained and enjoyed.
Sure.
I've been through this book and actually marked the ones that I like. Hold on a minute. But I sometimes have to go through a few pages until I find one of the ones I've marked. That gives you an idea of... like the general quality of the book. Most of them are poor. Come on. Fucking where's an... Oh, this is annoying. I'm going to have to edit these bits out. Just, can you hear the sound of me thumbing through the pages, listeners? Desperately trying to find a decent joke.
Just pick a random one.
Yeah, but I'm trying to find ones that... Okay. No, I've done that one.
It's not... What do you mean you've done it?
I did it on
the podcast.
I did it at a YouTube live earlier this year, and I did that joke.
Oh yeah, well, we'll talk about your YouTube lives on my YouTube live.
Okay,
but
okay,
all right.
Which I may have done this too. Which doesn't matter. Which is
I don't know them, so they okay. People can listen if they've heard it. They'll be like, oh, is he going to get it? Oh, is the comedian going to get the joke?
Okay, here's the joke. Which is braver? Which one is more brave? Which one has more bravery? Which one is more courageous?
I get it. Yeah.
I just hope everyone else does. Which is braver, Paul? A stone or a rock?
So presumably I have to give the answer and why.
Yes.
Which is braver, a stone or a rock? I bet you the answer's neither because blah, blah, blah.
No, it's a rock because it's...
solid.
Okay, so I'll help you with some clues. So brave, courageous. Can you think of another word for brave? Fortune favours the...
Brave.
No.
Fortune favors.
These are the voyages of the Star Trek Enterprise. Our mission to... You don't know that?
No.
To boldly go where no...
Where no man has gone before.
Yeah, to boldly... So bold is...
Oh, bolder. Oh, bolder. Okay.
Bolder, you see.
Okay.
So, which is braver, a stone or a rock? It's a rock because it's a little...
Bolder.
Yeah, it's a little bolder.
Oh, it's a little bolder. See, that's a good one as well.
Listeners, I mean, I've done that before. I think I did a covered that one in a premium episode.
I imagine
episode.
you could do a whole one-hour episode on that joke explaining...
Yeah. Well, I did do a massive series of episodes of Luke's English Podcast Premium about homophones,
which are
words that sound the same, but they're different, like bolder and bolder.
Yeah.
Bolder, B-O-L-D-E-R, meaning more bold or more confident,
yeah,
more brave.
Often the dad jokes are homonyms, aren't they?
Yes, that's right, they are. And bolder, B-O-U-L-D-E-R, which is like a large rock.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Okay. Should we do one more
go
of
on.
These? I'm quite enjoying this.
Crap dad jokes. I should do this. What I need to do for my live show is figure. Oh, you've got an iPhone 4 up there.
I do indeed.
Oh mate, that's cool, because I just got an iPhone 12 mini.
Okay,
go on,
Paul. Yep. Which one is you might know this. This is like a kind of playground joke, a lollipop stick joke. Which is faster, hot or cold? Which is faster, hot or cold? Let me know if you need a clue.
Yeah.
The answer is it's hot because... Do you want me to just tell you the answer?
Go on.
So, which is faster, hot or cold? Hot because anyone can catch a cold.
It's good. But yeah, I get it. Anyone can catch a cold.
Okay, that's enough of that. That was number 12, guess the punchline, and I don't know.
Oh, you know what would be better for that one is probably guess the setup. That probably is easier to do. If you give the punchline,
okay.
I reckon I could come up with a... Because it's so difficult to come up with the punchline there. Like, if you, I mean, it's not... It's completely... It's not that there's no context, but it's just a really...
Like, for example, I would say a rock because it's a little bolder, and you'd say which is braver. It's still difficult.
Yeah, it's still difficult, but I feel like it might be easier. Go on, try it, and if it's not, then... Then it's not.
Okay. Let's see. I just need to find ones that are the appropriate length. I like this joke though. This is a bonus joke, listeners.
Go on.
Patient in a doctor's surgery. The patient says, Doctor, I keep seeing spots in front of my eyes. And the doctor says, have you seen an optician? And the patient says, no, just spots.
So stupid.
I know, it's great, isn't it? Okay, fucking come on, find another one, for goodness sake. Most of them are crap.
This is the title of the book, so that makes sense.
Turning the pages of this book is such an interesting thing for people to listen to. The sounds of the book in my hands. It's such engaging content. I switched my microphone off by mistake. Come on. Fucking fucks. Do you ever go on a swearing
all the time
when you're at home? Like, just fucking fuck. Okay, all right, this one also is going to be potentially rewarding for those listeners who listen to my premium episodes, because they might know this one. I hope that's going to be rewarding. Little reminder. So, now this is guess the punchline.
All right.
Okay, a vicar was walking through the church's graveyard when he came across a man sitting on a bench. Morning, said the vicar. And what did the man say?
He said he would. Okay, the man would have said, "No, it's the afternoon, actually." Afternoon?
No.
Evening?
No. Do it the other way around. Think of
morning.
Yeah, it's got two meanings, right? Morning, it's got two meanings.
Yeah,
yeah. All right. What are the two meanings of morning?
Well, one is it's either the morning or the afternoon or the evening, and the other version is that you're crying, you're in mourning.
Right. So, but which one is the vicar saying? So, the vicar's walking through.
He's saying good morning.
Yeah, morning, and the man goes, "No, just having a rest."
Oh, is that the thing? I'm just having a rest.
Yes.
Okay.
Like, morning, good morning.
Yeah.
But the man thinks he's saying, are you mourning?
Yeah, all right. Okay.
Okay, that didn't work.
Yeah, it's fine. Give up. Finish it.
Stop. Okay. I can't help myself. What did Snow White sing while she was waiting for her photos to arrive in the post? What did Snow White sing while she was waiting for her photos to arrive in the post? The answer is the name of a jazz standard, a song that's been covered by various jazz musicians. What did Snow White, who was a famous princess, sing while she was waiting for her photos to arrive in the post?
Seven.
The answer is, "Someday my prince will come." Prince.
Oh, God.
Prince.
Yeah, Prince. Another homonym, Prince. As in Prince William, but also Prince as in my photo, Prince. So when you print out a photo, it's exactly. Prince.
Prince. It's like, how do you find Will Smith in the snow? Check for the fresh prince.
Oh. Shocking.
The fresh prince of Bel-Air.
Yeah.
Okay, right. That's enough of that. And listeners, ladies and gentlemen, I think that is the end of this fabulous game show, which has been called Random Questions with Paul Taylor. I think we should all give Paul a round of applause. Congratulations, Paul. You got a total of 12 points in the game. And your prize today is... oh, God, we haven't thought about this in advance.
I already had it. It was a cup of tea.
Hey, actually, you know what? Keep talk. No. I've got a gift for you, but I'm going to give it to you on your YouTube Live later on, because I want to ingratiate myself with your audience.
Okay.
I want them to like me.
Okay.
So I'm going to give you a gift on
them. They already do. By the way, there's a bunch of your ninjas on. I get now and again a couple of messages being like, "Oh, ninja Lepster here."
Oh, nice. All right. Lepsters represent. Paul, thanks for coming back on the podcast. How do you feel now after an hour and 15 minutes of this?
Yeah, I feel good. I feel it's good. I feel way underprepared for the live tonight. But also, the thing is, the cool thing with the live is it's the audience that decides what happens, because they'll ask questions and then we'll just go off on a tangent based on someone's question, who's going to be like, "Oh, about the English language, what do you do about this?" And then it'll just end up being whatever it is.
You get lost in a grammar.
Yeah, that's the cool. That's what I do like about the live. There's part of me that I want to have like specific games or segments. I do have an idea actually.
Yeah.
Because I used to do a segment called Express Yourself, which was give me your favorite expressions and I'll try and translate them literally into French or in English, whichever the one way is. But I think we could do one which is, do you understand, like the French expression for you. Like, if we get the audience to give their favorite French expressions and see if you know them. And like le cul bordé de nouilles, which you didn't know, the arse full of noodles.
Right.
And then... your reaction on
that's
them.
Good. That's good.
That could be fun, couldn't it?
Okay, that'll be fun. All right then.
So I would invite your listeners to come and watch tonight, but they're not going to hear this episode before it's out.
Well, if my listeners followed me on Twitter, then they'd see that I tweeted about it today.
Oh, what they could do, though, is if you are listening to this now, you can go back on my YouTube channel and re-watch the live, because it will have happened and it'll be on my YouTube channel. If you just type in Luke Taylor... Luke Thompson, Paul Taylor, it should come up in the search. It's my YouTube channel. It's called Happy Hour Live. That is the name of the live show.
If they type Luke Taylor, Paul Thompson, it'll probably come up.
Yeah, Luke Taylor, Paul Thompson. That's fine.
But in any case, I'll put the video of our live that we're going to record tonight. I'll put it onto the page for the episode on the website. So this is like weird sort of
inception
where we're in the past, but we're going to be in the future. But when the future has happened, when the future becomes the past, I'll upload that onto the page for this thing that will then get uploaded onto the internet.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
No, it doesn't, but it doesn't matter.
No.
Yeah. I'm going to end the episode now. Thank you very much.
Because I'm also going to tell the people on the live tonight. I'm like, "Oh, me and Luke just recorded a podcast, which will be on his channel in the coming time." So it's going to be this weird...
We recorded it in the past, but when it's available in the future...
Oh, God.
That's right.
I love it.
Okay. Well, on that confusing note, I think it's time to end this.
Yeah, it's been fun. Thanks for having me back on the podcast.
Pleasure. And next time we must get Amber. I hope she doesn't feel like put out.
No,
that she wasn't brought into this.
No, because she knows that we know that she wouldn't have been available anyway.
Yes,
because it was like either weekends or evenings.
It's still nice to be asked so that you can
then
say no.
That's the English side of it, though, isn't it? It's like, "Oh, I wish I was asked, even though I'd have said no. I didn't get asked."
You could say that she couldn't be asked.
Oh, as the Americans.
Rather than she couldn't be asked.
Yeah. I got a bunch of comments on that video being like, oh, I didn't realise it was I couldn't be asked. I'm like, I know, because you're American and you don't hear it properly.
Yeah. We've talked about this before, that the expression, as you said earlier, I just can't be asked. Americans think it's I can't be asked.
Because they hear the same thing.
Yes.
Because when we say I can't, if you were to say quickly, I can't be asked, like, it would sound the same. Say it quickly without trying to pronounce
it. I can't be asked. Asked. I can't be asked.
Can't be asked.
And I can't be asked. It's almost the same. Yeah. But also Americans, it's like asked.
Exactly.
They're like, ask is not, yeah. It's not on their radar. Yeah. So
they'll be like, no, it is ask, because we've invented it, and you're just like, shut up.
Yes. Separated by common language. Right. Shall we stop before we get sidetracked by another tangent?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Listeners, thank you for listening. You're wonderful, wonderful people. Best of luck out there generally. And we will speak to you again on the podcast soon. But for now, it's time to say goodbye. Bye. 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 Thanks for listening to Luke's English Podcast. For more information, visit teacherluke.co.uk.